Welcome to our worship for the second Sunday of Advent on December 6th. We're so delighted that you are with us. And today we have a special guest. Kevin Davis is with us, so thank you very much for coming, Kevin. We really appreciate it. And Rick Leben is here on piano.
Good morning.
And we also have our scripture reader is Ellie Leben. If you are around Fitzroy Harbor at all in the evening, it's quite a sight to see our churches lit up. So I encourage you to drive by, or you can come to the village and take a walk. You won't be disappointed. From the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 3 to 5. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill will be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." This voice is a messenger proclaiming and celebrating the power of God to transform the world. Who are our messengers? What do their voices sound like? On this second Sunday of Advent, we listen carefully so we can hear and understand messengers of peace. Let us pray. Gracious God, open our ears so we can truly hear your message of hope and peace. Help us to still the chatter and noise so we can figure out what's really important. Quiet our hearts and mind when we feel anxious or uncertain. Give us your encouraging spirit when we feel down or depressed. Inspire our Advent preparations as we prepare for the birth of Jesus. Be with us in our worship as we celebrate messengers of peace. Amen.
Today we light our second candle on the Advent wreath. It is the candle of peace. Martin Luther King once said, "Peace is not the absence of conflict, but the presence of justice." Peace comes when all people are treated equally. Peace comes with patience and hope. Peace is a sense of wholeness and calm, even when life is tough. Jesus is called the Prince of Peace because he came to bring harmony and understanding as we continue our Advent season. May the light of Christ shine in our hearts as we celebrate the gifts of hope and peace.
Our first hymn is from Voices United 661, Come to My Heart.
The second reading this morning is taken from Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. This is the good news about Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It began as the prophet Isaiah had written. God said, "I will send my messenger ahead of you." Someone is shouting in the desert, "Get the road ready for the Lord. Make a straight path for him to travel." So John appeared in the desert, baptizing and preaching. "Turn away from your sins and be baptized," he told the people, "and God will forgive your sins." Many people from the province of Judea and the city of Jerusalem went out to hear John. They confessed their sins, and he baptized them in the Jordan River. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. He announced to the people, "The man who will come after me is much greater than I am. I am not good enough even to bend down and untie his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." May God add his blessing to these holy words.
Messengers come in all shapes and sizes. Here, John the Baptist is known for dressing in camel's hair with a leather belt and eating locusts and wild honey. This description is strange to our ears, but for those who know the scriptures, John the Baptist is wearing the wardrobe of Elijah. In the book of 2 Kings, Elijah is described as a hairy man with a leather belt around his waist. This descriptive reference is intentional, pointing out to the readers of Mark that John is like Elijah, an important prophet we need to listen to. Who are our present-day messengers? One that comes quickly to mind is the teenager Greta Thunberg. She has spoken bravely to the world about climate change. She has been ridiculed and criticized, and her motives have been questioned. And she still keeps speaking, unafraid of making world leaders uncomfortable. Messengers don't need to be famous, however, and they don't need weird wardrobes. Think about an important person in your life. How did they prepare the way for you? I immediately think of my friend and mentor, David. He pushed me into doing so many things that I didn't really want to do. He would not take no for an answer. When he died too young, I just couldn't shake his words, and I still hear them. His funeral was the beginning of hearing God's call for my life. And he prepared the way for me to understand myself in a deeper way. It might not be an accident that David was a teacher. You might also recall an important teacher in your life, someone who encouraged you and inspired you. Another famous person who prepared the way for the civil rights movement is a young girl named Rosa Parks. But in reading about that history, there are actually two other young women who did the same thing prior to Rosa. Their names are Sarah Evans and Claudette Colvin. Sarah Evans, a member of the United States military, refused to move to the back of the bus in 1951. Claudette Colvin, a black 15-year-old teenager, refused to give up her seat to a white person 9 months prior to Rosa Parks. Both Sarah and Claudette were arrested and detained in jail. And you see, these stories all make me think of Viola Desmond, who in 1946, long before Sarah or Claudette or Rosa, refused to move to the black section of a movie theater in New Glasgow, Nova Scotia. Viola was arrested and never received justice in her lifetime. Her photo on our $10 bill is a recognition of the posthumous pardon that she eventually did receive. It's true these persons might seem long ago and far away, and it might be strange to even mention them when, you know, we live in a predominantly white community. But I do think it's important to recognize the beginning of movements and how it shapes our world today. For we do have neighbors of all shapes and sizes, all skin tones and cultural backgrounds, and it's important that everyone be treated with respect. As you heard earlier in our service, Martin Luther King once said, "Peace is not the absence of conflict, but the presence of justice." The beginning of justice comes when messengers herald the truth. So it's no surprise that the beginning of the book of Mark begins with these words, "The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Every opportunity begins at the beginning. That's when awakening to the messengers is important. It's easy to dismiss these messengers, like so many have done with Greta Thunberg, because we don't like what they have to say. They are disruptors. My friend David was always disrupting my life with schemes and projects. And these young Black women who refused to be belittled by prejudicial laws disrupted the status quo, and that led to big changes. And yet it's important and sad to realize that these moments are just the beginning. I mean, didn't we all despair when we heard of the murders of innocent Black men and women and innocent Indigenous men and women throughout North America and beyond? It makes us realize that our messengers knew that there was a long road ahead of them. And if we want a peaceful world, it's important to recall our messenger, John the Baptist, and the news he shared about the beginning of the ministry of Jesus. This event is spoken of by prophets like Elijah and Isaiah. John, who in Luke is described as the cousin of Jesus, stands in a long tradition of messengers who try to prepare the way. John knows the people have to cleanse their souls of the sins that hold them back so they can awaken to the truth of Jesus. If you're mired in a cloud of anger and prejudice against others, how can you see what's right in front of your face? By being baptized into a new understanding of what is important, John disrupts the established order of things, and he pays a price for that disruption. He is murdered at the whim of a spoiled young girl who gets her evil father to silence his message. But if messengers have done their work properly, they cannot be silenced. They stand up and speak their truth. And if the truth touches hearts, it never dies. Jesus spoke the truth of his understanding of God's dream for the world. He shared good news. Good news of healing, hoping, peacekeeping, love, and joy. The bad news implicit in this good news is that it disrupts the powerful and the greedy and the violent leaders who want to be in charge. Well, messengers don't care about the risk. They don't care about their own discomfort. They call everyone to repentance because they know it's the only way forward. And I do want to bring this message back home to all of the people of our own community. One thing I'm seeing right now is the slow death of our country churches, caused by a lot of different factors, but one of them is apathy. Right now, we have a number of churches on the brink of closing. Everyone wants to see churches in our communities, but not everyone wants to contribute to their health. I fear that one day we'll hear that refrain, "Oh, I'm so sorry we don't have a church in our community anymore." And you know how painful this is, because if you're part of Bethel St. Andrews United Church, you know that we had to close Bethel United Church, although now we are one amalgamated congregation. We proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, trying to help our communities understand the power of healing and hope. And without that voice, without that commitment, who will speak for the vulnerable? And who will care for the soul and spirit of our neighbors? In the 1830s, when Charles Sheriff began to settle this community, he built a log cabin as an ecumenical church for the entire population. He was a messenger of tolerance and understanding and of the need for faith to stitch a vibrant village. And then the groups that worshiped in that log cabin outgrew its space and they built their own churches. And now in the year 2020, some of our churches are struggling to maintain that vital voice. Now, I think, and I'm pretty confident that here at Bethel St. Andrews, we're in a good place. But others are not so fortunate. How do we become the messengers of the amazing good news of Jesus Christ? How do we prepare the way for the generations to come? Only by listening carefully and awakening our hearts to the messengers can we begin again. And this is our call, and this is our privilege. Remember, messengers come in all shapes and sizes. And they don't have to be famous, and they don't have to wear weird wardrobes. Perhaps that messenger is you. Amen.
And if you see your sister falling by the way, just stop and say, you're going the wrong way. You've got to try a little kindness, just show a little kindness, just shine your light for everyone to see. If you try a little kindness, then you'll overlook the blind. Of the narrow-minded people on the narrow-minded street. Don't walk around the down and out. Lend a helping hand instead of doubt. And the kindness that you show every day will help someone along their way. Got to try a little kindness, just show a little kindness, just shine your light for everyone to see. And if you try a little kindness, then you'll overlook the blindness of narrow-minded people and narrow-minded streets. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kevin. Thank you. That's a wonderful message. Try a little kindness. It's not complicated. Kindness goes a long way. And thank you too, Rick. And I just, I also wanted to say, we have one person behind the scenes who helps us most weeks, and it's my dear husband, James, and I want to thank him for doing all the technical. And thank you too, Ellie, for reading the scripture. We are here because of all of the gifts that people offer to do our worship services together. And without them, we really couldn't do them. So that's why we are so grateful. And we're also extremely grateful for the financial gifts that continue to keep Bethel St. Andrews going. And even the gifts that we give to other churches or other organizations that are so important in our community. So we want to thank God for your gifts and for the gifts that you offer to this church. Let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. O God, we long for peace. Peace inside us, in our hearts, in our minds, in our bodies, in our soul. We long for peace in our homes, in our friendships, in our marriages, in our extended families. We long for peace at the dinner table, in front of the TV, on the couch, in our beds, walking our dog. Oh God, why does it seem so hard to find peace sometimes? Help us to breathe deeply. Soothe our tired muscles. Find a pillow for our head. Assure us with your gentle touch and remind us of your love. Turn our spirits towards your spirit so we can feel your warm embrace. Teach us to trust you deeply and completely. For the sake of peace, help us to be messengers. Help us to tell the old, old stories of Jesus and his love. Help us to find the energy and the courage to proclaim the good news of hope being born into the world. And most of all, O God, we pray for peace where people are hungry. We pray for peace where people are at war. We pray for peace where women and children are at risk. We pray for peace where religious strife leads to tension and grief. Thank you. Thank you for sending your messenger, John the Baptist. And thank you for all the messengers you've sent to each one of us. For him and for all these persons, we give you thanks. We pray all this as we say the prayer Jesus taught to us. Our Father, who art in heaven, thanked be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our closing hymn is Voices United 44, It came upon a midnight clear. Messengers of peace, speak of reconciliation and forgiveness. Messengers of peace, play musical instruments. Messengers of peace, paint canvases and make movies. Messengers of peace, come in all shapes and sizes and all ages. Listen carefully and become your own messenger for God. Amen.
Still the water. Put your hand in the hand of the man who comes.
taught me how to pray before I reached the age of seven.
Age of seven.
When I'm down on my knees, that's when I'm close to heaven. But he showed me enough of what it takes to get you through. Now put your hand in the hand of the man who stilled the water.
He stilled the water.
Now put your hand in the hand of the man who calmed the sea.
He calmed the sea.
Now take a look at yourself and you can look at others differently. By putting your hand